The bones that make up the shoulder girdle are the humerus, the scapula, the clavicle, the sternum, and the ribs. The shoulder girdle is composed of three synovial joints: the glenohumeral joint, the acromioclavicular joint, and the sternoclavicular joint. We will review these structures from anterior, posterior, lateral, medial, and transverse viewpoints. We will progress gradually, starting with the most relevant structures of the osseous anatomy, then working through the cartilage, the synovial capsule, the fibrous capsule, and ending with the ligaments. We will start with the osseous architecture of the scapula in an anterior view. The scapula has a flat triangular shape with three borders: middle, superior, and inferior. It also has three angles: inferior, lateral, and superior. The anterior surface is facing the ribs and is thus called the costal surface. The lateral angle widens, forming the glenoid, which articulates with the head of the humerus. The neck of the glenoid is the transition from the body of the scapula to the glenoid fossa. At the top of the glenoid neck is the coracoid process, which rises from its base and protrudes anteriorly and laterally. On the posterior surface, we can see the spinous process and the acromion. In an axial cut of the scapula passing through the equator of the glenoid, we can see the shape of the scapula as it becomes thicker from medial to lateral. In a lateral view, we can see the flat shape of the scapula. The glenoid fossa, when viewed laterally, has an inverted pear shape because the inferior half is wider than the superior half. Anteriorly and superiorly, it has a smooth concavity. At the superior edge of the glenoid fossa is the supraglenoid tubercle for the insertion of the tendon of the long head of the biceps. At the inferior edge is the infraglenoid tubercle for the insertion of the long head of the triceps. We can also see the spinous process at the posterior surface of the scapula. Once again, we see how the coracoid process projects anteriorly from the superior border of the scapula. On the posterior surface of the scapula, the most relevant structure is the spinous process. It rises from the medial border and continues laterally, forming the acromion. The spinous process divides the scapula into two parts. The supraspinous fossa is located superiorly, and the infraspinous fossa is located inferiorly. Medial to the coracoid process, on the superior border, is the suprascapular notch for the passage of the suprascapular nerve. The lateral widening of the spinous process can be better seen from a superior view. At the tip, the spinous process forms the acromion. At the lateral surface, the acromion has a flat articular surface for the lateral end of the clavicle. The clavicle is a long bone which spans from the acromion to the sternum. Seen from the front, it is straight. At the inferior surface and laterally, just over the coracoid process, are the conoid and trapezoid tubercles for the insertion of the conoid and trapezoid ligaments, which form the coracoclavicular ligament. From the top, we can see the S shape of the clavicle. The medial convexity is anterior, and the lateral convexity is posterior. The humerus is a long bone. Proximally, we can observe the head, which forms one-third of a sphere for articulation with the glenoid fossa. The greater and lesser tuberosities are processes for the insertion of the tendons of the rotator cuff. In between them is the bicipital groove for the tendon of the long head of the biceps. The neck of the humerus is the transition from the head to the shaft of the humerus. The deltoid tuberosity is located laterally and distally. From the top, we can again observe the surface of the humeral head. Again, the lesser and greater tuberosities are separated by the bicipital groove for the passage of the tendon of the long head of the biceps. The intertubercular groove is closed by a transverse humeral ligament, forming a canal. The ribs in the scapula form the scapulothoracic joint, which participates in the movement of the shoulder girdle. The shoulder girdle consists of three synovial joints, which are the glenohumeral, acromioclavicular, and sternoclavicular joints. We will first see the glenohumeral joint, which is of the ball and socket type. The glenoid fossa is covered with cartilage. This cartilage is thicker in the periphery of the glenoid and thinner in the center. This can also be seen in a transverse view of the glenoid. As for the humerus, the head of the humerus is covered with cartilage. The cartilage is thicker at the center of the head and thinner at the periphery, distributed such that it is complementary to the glenoid fossa. The tendon of the long head of the biceps enters the glenohumeral joint through the bicipital groove and inserts itself into the supraglenoid tubercle. This tendon continues anteriorly and posteriorly all the way around the rim of the glenoid fossa, forming the glenoid labrum. In a transverse view, we can see that the labrum is a fibrocartilaginous structure that makes the glenoid fossa deeper and increases the contact surface for the head of the humerus. It is also the insertion site of the glenohumeral ligaments. And, once again, as seen from the top, the tendon of the long head of the biceps comes into the glenohumeral joint through the bicipital groove, inserts into the supratubercular groove, and extends anteriorly and posteriorly into the labrum. The synovial capsule lines all of the deep surface of the fibrous capsule. The limit or insertion of the synovial capsule at the glenoid is the edge of the labrum. At the humeral head, the capsule inserts into the edge of the cartilage and includes the bicipital groove. At the posterior surface, there is an area void of cartilage included in the synovial compartment. The synovial capsule has expansions which form the bursae. Now we are going to see the ligaments. The ligaments of this joint mainly cover the anterior and inferior areas. The glenohumeral fibrous capsule is formed by three ligaments, which are the superior, middle, and inferior glenohumeral ligaments. These ligaments are loose in the mid-range of motion and get tight in external rotation or abduction, preventing the head of the humerus from sliding out of the glenoid fossa. The superior glenohumeral ligament originates in the anterior and superior region of the glenoid and inserts into the floor of the bicipital groove. The middle glenohumeral ligament originates from the superior labrum and inserts into the edge of the articular surface of the humeral head. This ligament is loose in internal rotation and tightens in external rotation. The inferior glenohumeral ligament originates anteriorly and posteriorly from the inferior half of the labrum and inserts into the edge of the articular surface of the humeral head. It forms a hammock-like structure, which, simply put, prevents the humeral head from sliding inferiorly out of the glenoid fossa. This ligament is loose in adduction and tightens in abduction. These are the ligaments of the glenohumeral fibrous capsule, which is a continuous structure when seen from outside the joint. The acromioclavicular joint is a plain synovial joint. The acromial articular surface is at the medial surface of the acromion. The distal end of the clavicle is similarly covered with cartilage. The fibrous capsule surrounds all of the acromioclavicular joint. The articular surfaces are separated by a meniscus that inserts into the superior portion of the capsule. This joint is further, and more importantly, stabilized by the coracoclavicular ligament. This ligament has two portions which run from the superior surface of the coracoid process. The conoid ligament starts more posteriorly from the base of the coracoid, widening as it goes into the conoid tubercle of the clavicle. The trapezoid ligament runs from the base of the coracoid to the trapezoid tubercle at the inferior surface of the distal clavicle. The sternoclavicular joint is a cellar synovial joint. The medial end of the clavicle is wide. The sternal articular surface is at the clavicular notch of the sternum. Both surfaces are covered with cartilage. The fibrous capsule surrounds all of the acromioclavicular joint, mainly forming the anterior and posterior sternoclavicular ligaments. The articular volume is divided by an articular disc. This joint is further stabilized by the costoclavicular ligament. This ligament is composed of two components which run from the inferior surface of the clavicle to the first rib. The posterior fibers go from the rib to the clavicle, oriented medially. The anterior fibers go from the rib to the clavicle, oriented laterally. There are another three ligaments which are intrinsic to the scapula. That is, they run from one point to another of the scapula. The superior transverse scapular ligament spans the suprascapular notch, forming a closed space for the passage of the scapular nerve from anterior to posterior into the supraspinous fossa of the scapula. The inferior transverse scapular ligament goes from the lateral border of the scapular spine to the back of the neck of the scapula. It is also called the spinoglenoid ligament. It forms an osteofibrous tunnel. The suprascapular nerve gives off a branch for the infraspinatus muscle, which goes into the infraspinous fossa through this tunnel. Finally, the third ligament is the coracoacromial ligament, which runs from the tip of the coracoid process to the anteroinferior surface of the acromion. We have talked about the synovial joints of the shoulder girdle, the glenohumeral, acromioclavicular, and sternoclavicular. However, the scapula also glides over the thorax. Both of these structures are covered with muscles. The specific term for a joint in which there is gliding of one muscle over another is cissarcosis. This is the scapulothoracic joint. The muscles glide thanks to the presence of bursae in between them. This allows for the scapula to glide anterolaterally or posteromedially around the thorax, superiorly or inferiorly, and to rotate. We dedicate this video to all the medical students that worked at home or in hospitals during the COVID-19 pandemic of 2020.